what's up? This is Anupam. Welcome back. This is the 7th tutorial on the video tutorial series on STM32F4 Discovery Board. You can check out my website www.logicvoltage.com. You will find all these tutorials there also. You can even check out the video store at the website. You will find very good video tutorial series there with a very less price. People are buying it, talking about it. You can also buy it and I'm sure you will not be disappointed. You can even get in touch with me also in case of any query. Just go to contact us page and fill up the form and I will reply. You can check out the forum also. For any tutorial related queries, you can post comment there and I will reply back there so that other people can also see the comments and what discussion is going on. Please make some donations so that we can continue to create the free tutorials. You are welcome to choose any amount as you like for donation. We will be highly appreciated. You can also support us by giving a thumbs up at this YouTube video and subscribe my YouTube channel. Thanks. In the previous tutorial, we have set up this circuit to use a switch. We have 4 LEDs here. We have divided these 4 LEDs into 2 groups. Let's suppose first 2 LEDs are group 1 and last 2 LEDs are group 2. These 2 are connected to PD0 and PD1. And then we have one switch here. One end of this switch is connected to 3-volt power supply from Discovery board. And the other end is connected to PA1 on the Discovery board. Now in this tutorial, we will write the program in such a way that we will toggle these two groups when this switch is pressed. So suppose if group 1 LEDs is switched on right now and then we press the switch, then group 2 LEDs will light up and group 1 LEDs will switch off. And then again if we press the switch, then group 2 LEDs will be off and group 1 LEDs will be on. Hence, as I said, the LEDs will toggle on each press of switch. Let's start writing the program now. Okay, so let's create a new project. Let's name this new project Switch LED Program. Okay, so now our project is created. Let's correct the clock settings. Let's delete the comments. Also delete these lines, we don't need them. Okay, so now let's start writing the code. Let's first configure our all 4 LEDs. Now initialize them by calling this function. And start the clock of port D. I am not going through the steps in details here. If you don't understand these statements, then please see my previous tutorials first. Now we need to initialize the PA1 pin on which the switch is connected. So let's do that. First enable the clock of port A. Now configure the PA1 pin. Now you see here we have chosen the input mode. Till now we have only used the output mode here, but now it's input mode. Next is output type is push-pull. Then next, now here we are using the pull-down. That's because we want the PA1 pin to be by default in pull down or zero voltage. That means this pin will only go high when switch is pressed, and else it will always be on low voltage. Then next is speed is 50 megahertz. Now initialize the pin by calling this function. Now we have initialized the GPIO pin PA1 in input mode. Hence our all 4 LEDs are initialized and our switch pin is also initialized. Now next thing is we need to write the logic of how our LEDs will behave when switch is pressed. Now to detect if the switch is pressed, we use this function. This function is from the STM libraries. This function actually tells us if the bit is set or reset on a particular GPIO pin. As we have passed GPIO A port and pin 1, thus this function will return bit set or bit reset. Now if we got bit set, then that means the switch is pressed. That's because bit set means logic 1 and logic 1 means 3 volt. And you will get 3 volt on PA1 pin only if the switch is pressed. That's because the other end of switch is connected to 3 volt. Now if we get bit reset from this function, then switch is not pressed. Now on the basis of this information, we can write our logic. Now with this line, we are checking if the bit is set or not. If bit is set, then the condition will be true and the code written in the brackets will be executed. Now we need one more variable here. This variable we have declared to track which group of LEDs are currently switched on, so that when we press the switch, the current group of LEDs will be switched off and the other group of LEDs will be switched on. Let's write the remaining code. Now you can see that I am changing the press integer value on the basis of if the button is pressed. If button is pressed, then I am changing the press integer value. If it is 1, then I am changing it to 0, or if it is 0, then I am changing it to 1. That's because on the basis of this press value, I am switching on and off the LEDs. Now when the code started execution, the press value is 0. Now this if block will check if the switch is pressed. Right now, let's assume it's not pressed. So this if block will become false. Now here, if press is equal to 0, so this is true, as currently press is 0. So this block will execute. LED 1 and LED 2 will switch on, and LED 3 and LED 4 will be switch off. Now let's say we press the switch. So this if condition will become true. Next, it will check if press value is 0. This will now become false, as press value is now changed to 1. And hence this else part will run. Here it will turn off the first two LEDs and turn on the last two LEDs. Thus it toggle kind of behavior that we wanted to achieve. Okay, so now let's run this code and see what will happen on the discovery board. Okay, now our program is running on the board. But you can see it's not what we expected. Even the LEDs are running in group, but they're supposed to toggle on switch press. But you can see that it's toggling, but not perfectly what we expected. I'm just touching and it's fluctuating. So what could be the problem? I know few of you guys would be thinking that the switch is not properly placed on the breadboard and it's kind of loose, hence this behavior. But in real, this is not the reason. This is actually a problem you will also see when you run it. Let's understand what's the problem. Let's suppose this is a switch. Now the moment I press the switch, the 3 volt will pass through it. And then I release the switch, the 3 volt will stop passing through it. Now let's see this in a timeline way. Now let's assume right now the switch is not pressed and PA1 pin is in 0 volt. Now I'll press the switch, so it will go to 3 volt on PA1 pin. Now I release the switch, so the PA1 pin will again came down to 0 volt. Now I again press the switch, it again goes to 3 volt. And release the switch and again came down to 0 volt. So this is the idle behavior. But in reality, it's not what happens. Let's see what actually happens. Let's now assume right now the switch is not pressed, so 0 volt on PA1 pin. Now we press the switch, then reach to 3 volt. Now I release the switch and reach to 0 volt. Now again I press the switch and again it goes to 3 volt. And now I release the switch and PA1 pin will came down to 0 volt. So you can see that this transition from 0 volt to 3 volt and 3 volt to 0 volt is not smooth. When we are pressing the switch, we find some spikes before it becomes stable. Now these spikes are very small, nearly 10 to 20 nanoseconds. But microcontroller detect these very easily. And microcontroller thinks like we are pressing the switch so many times. And that's why we see that kind of behavior. This problem is called debouncing effect. Because the voltage level at the PA1 pin is bouncing from 0 volt to 3 volt. Now to solve this problem, we will add a delay. Let's get back to program. Now to solve this problem, we will add some delay in this if block. Now this delay function is actually making the microcontroller to stop checking if the switch is pressed by delaying. That means the moment it finds the switch is pressed, then it will not again quickly check until some delay time is passed. In this way, we can solve this problem to some extent. Let's now save this again and run this again on the discovery board and see if the debouncing problem is solved or not. Now our new code is running. Now you can see that the problem is solved to some extent. Although not completely, we are still seeing this sometimes, but still a lot improvement than the previous situation. That's great. So now our program worked. Okay guys, in this tutorial, we have learned how to program the GPIO pin in input mode. We have used a switch for testing input mode, and then we got to know about the debouncing effect in the switch that we have taken care of by adding a simple delay. I hope you guys enjoyed the tutorial. Once again, this is Anupam from www.logicvoltage.com, and thanks for watching. Bye.